And with that, we open up the Audio Quitter Podcast.
That's the official open.
The official open. By the way, I read somewhere that Bruce Jenner is Republican.
Yes.
Right? Caitlyn Jenner.
Yes.
So I thought of a great thing. Trannies for Trump. Right? How great is that? It's right in his face. I mean, do I have to keep thinking up these great slogans? Right? Trannies for Trump. Trampies. Trumpies. I'm a Trumpy. A tranny for Trump. That's fantastic. Trump's like, I moved on her. I grabbed her fake pussy. When you're a celebrity, you can grab their fake pussy. That's fantastic. Trannies for Trump. Trampies, Trumpies, Trumpies. Eric Trump says it's amazing. That's amazing. It's an amazing idea. Women are amazing. Women are amazingly funny. I sat down and watched the two women show amazing. Trampy, Trump, Tramp. What are we doing? Introing what? Were you introing?
We're introing.
Right? What?
We're introing the show, the second show.
Second show, which is what? Oh, Joe Buck. Well, I got to tell you, what you're about to hear is my analysis, part analysis of what happened. More detail than any time you heard the story, the Joe Buck night. Joe's book career, my book career. Well, I have a book career. Joe wrote a book. But, you know, I was thinking, Joe Buck's, you say, why does Joe Buck get a book biography? Who's interested? Well, a lot of people are, because I was thinking about it. He is the voice of the Jeter era in baseball. 1996 is the first year Joe did the playoffs in the World Series on Fox, and it was also the first year of Derek Jeter's career. He won Rookie of the Year and I think MVP in the series, or MVP in the All-Star Game, something. And the start of a blessed career. Dare I say the Jeffrey Mayer game. So was Joe Buck there for the Mayer game and the Bartlett game? The Barnett, what's the guy in Chicago?
Steve Bartman. You know, I think that was Tom Brenneman.
Oh, okay.
That did that game.
Right. But yeah, the Mayer thing is a Yankee Van version of Bartman. Yeah. Because the Yankees were up and it helped them.
Yeah, except it helped him.
That's what I said.
Yeah.
A Yankee fan version. Yankee fan version, we get helped. A Cub fan version, on you go with Moise Alou to the minors. Was it Moise or Yoshi? Which Alou was it?
Moise.
Was it Alou Gehrig?
Moise.
I am Moise. El barman es el reprobable. Es el inmenso bloque de ser el floquio. Marigo, 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 marigo. And, Trump, Erica Trampy, Trampy for Trump, Bartman Trampy, Trumpy, Transy, Tranny, Tranny for Trump, Trump Tang. Yep. So Joe Buck has been there forever in baseball, and, you know, think of me, Jeffrey Mayer grew up with him when he wasn't stealing a home run for. I mean, that Jeter, watch the tape of that. It's basically past the warning track into the field. It was a pop up to second. that shows that the Yankees are touched by an angel, and who is a touched by an angel? Derek Jeter. You know what I'm saying? Jeffrey Mayer reached out and grabbed that ball, and that let Jeter reach out and grab pussy for 20 years. He ran actress, Hollywood actress twat through that fucking apartment. Like a rum runner, like Joe Kennedy Sr. ran fucking booze with the Purple Detroit gang.
That's why Mark Grace didn't want to come here in 96.
Why?
Because he said, dude, I'm...
Jews?
I'm, yeah. It's Hymie Town.
Yeah. Yeah, that's it. By the way, they had Jesse Jackson. we have to try to get the tape of this. We had Jesse Jackson giving his input. Dare I say this input on all the racial inequality and stuff that's going on with Trump. And you can't, again, Jesse Jackson does not speak English. And I'm not talking about black accent and a bonnet. He doesn't speak a word of English. And the thing I always point to, jokingly, but it's true, is the Jackie Robinson eulogy. One of them is given, the main one was given by Jesse Jackson. Holy shit. Holy shit. He's got an afro the size of Denver. And he's a photo opportunist. When Martin Luther King got shot, he was in the entourage. Unless, you know, make sure you're not around LeBron James when you say posse. I'll get into that, too.
We've got Anthony Boza, the great Anthony Boza, on this tape that we're introducing. And Bob Levy and Dom, his son.
What about me? I'm here as well, right?
Yes.
And you? Anybody else bring their daughters?
No.
Well, we'll shoot for that. Take care, Bashir.
As boring as this is, it's more fun than my regular life.
What a crew of the night. The great Anthony Boza. Bob Levy is here, of course. You know, that's what you can hear between the laughter and the hair dye. I'm talking about like Stuttering John, working with John. Mm-hmm. In the back of the day, Bob, right? And John would, you know, you want more money than anybody. And, you know, he would do 2 minutes. He had 2 minutes on Gary's teeth and call himself a comedian. And then we'd have to go out and, you know, Bob would have to do 20 minutes and a half hour. I have to do an hour. And then he wants more money. Split the money.
And I wrote the tea jokes.
Yeah, of course. And he's back doing whippets. John's doing whippets.
Is he?
Wow. You ready whip cans all over the place. I'm like, did you
What ask? Is he, 16?
Yeah, exactly. I said, Puerto Rican.
Yeah. He's
I said,
a good
did
guy,
you
John.
Ask? Did you ask? Oh, shut up.
He brought us together, everyone together on
what
the road.
What does that mean?
And then we realized we had more talent. We moved on.
Yeah, no kidding.
Told him to find his own ride home.
Well, yeah. Well, he would go out and go, hey, guys, how you doing? Boston.
So that's a minute.
Boston. Hey, did you see Gary's teeth, really? You can carry them in a wheelbarrow. Oh, he's fat. Casey's gay. And now what do you like?
I'm going to get my driver, Nigga Paul, to pull around.
Hi, Nigga Paul. Nicholas Cage. Oh, my God. That's what he says. In his audition for the single most coveted voiceover job in the history of network television, John says nigger.
Wow.
He calls Nicholas Cage, Niggerless Cage.
Wow.
Nicholas Cage.
Is that like a character? Does he do like a black character? Guy doing Nick Cage lines?
No, he's a terrible stutterer.
Wow.
But that's how I got the job on Howard.
Yeah.
If I said, John, if you had a good no speech impediment, you'd be asking people unleaded or leaded at a fucking gas station. I mean, not what I like, John. Or whatever.
Whatever.
Great podcast here. Bob Levy. Bob, what have you been up to, man? It's been a while.
It's good. I'm separated. I have a new...
Separated from what?
My wife.
Society?
Yeah, well, yeah.
I'm going to get ready for the race wars up in Minnesota.
Well, no.
Are you? I love Christine.
No, we it was
what
nice.
Happened?
No, nothing happened. Nobody got hit.
Her sense of hearing came back?
Yeah. Her eyesight. No, basically, you know, she got a job in Cleveland, and she did her time here.
I mean, you're one of the... Did her time.
You know,
so is that what you, offer? What are you, like Leavenworth living with you?
Basically. It is.
For good behavior.
You got a woman to leave the New York, Philadelphia area to go back to Cleveland. You know how hard that is?
It's exactly. I can't even believe LeBron went
She's
back.
She's like, I'm getting
paid.
The fuck out of here.
Yeah.
Well, that's sad, because I like Christina.
Well, I got another one. I got another
one.
I got
that's
a
great.
Girlfriend.
Dama, how's your new mommy?
He likes you. You like her, right?
Yeah, she's the fifth one this week. She's the nicest
No, stop it. She's not the nice. Fifth one. She's very nice.
Bob gets a girlfriend. He needs laundry done. He gets a
No, but I'm actually...
You can always tell if I have a girlfriend if I have a Christmas tree up.
Is that what you do?
Good to I don't know. When they want to go, everyone wants a tree.
Yeah, that's where she goes, where are we going to put the tree? And I'm like, which fucking
sometimes
tree?
Sometimes it's still up in August. I get a girlfriend just for to take it down.
I'm homeschooling her kid.
What?
I'm a teacher.
Really?
Yeah. No, you're not. Yeah, I swear to God, I'm teaching her seventh grade. Uh-huh. So I'm actually learning with her.
Right. He calls me up the other day when I'm in real school, and he asked me what a Venn diagram
is. What's real school?
Like, I don't know, like public school. And then he's homeschooling this.
Like with classes and like a building.
See, don't we call that here school?
Yeah, exactly. I'm not
Were you homeschooled by him?
No, no.
First of all, do you I'm worried. You own shoes, right?
Yes, I do.
No. Okay.
He's got flip-flops on.
He's nuts.
Because I made it. Now I feel
and no
bad.
Socks.
Remember that joke I made at one of the roasts years ago when I was
Dom was
a young boy?
Yes, yeah. I remember that.
And I said that, you know, Dom's a good kid. Right now he's at the playground saying, it was December. He goes, you'll see someday my dad says I'll have a winter coat.
Yeah, I remember that.
And I said you were a good dad. I saw you wish him happy birthday from the...
Zany's dressing room.
The Zany's payphone in Vernon Hills, Illinois.
Artie, can I borrow a quarter? I got to call my son for his birthday.
No, I just, Dom's a good kid. He's got flip-flops on and it's Thanksgiving.
No, he's fucking nuts. There's no doubt about it.
Well, you're like a hippie, right? He's an artist. He plays the guitar.
He plays
and
everything.
The bass. Like John Entwistle.
Just like John Entwistle.
And Jack Bruce.
Well,
you are great, though, buddy. You are great. Let's get, I'm telling you, give him props.
Yeah.
You know, Bob, when he, you know, built you guys up and he came to that one gig I did. And, I'm thinking about the fake compliment, you know.
Yeah.
And I go, wow, it was amazing. Great job. So was there dissent in the band, though? What happened? Like, do you have a Yoko that showed up? Like, because you're not with that kid who was a lead singer anymore?
No, I am. I just we weren't talking for a while because we had some issues that happened. And basically,
I saw him backstage. He was taking too much bologna.
Home.
What's your problem?
Hands off the
Bob, did you get in a fight with his father? I could see that happening.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. They went to court over it.
Really? Get out of here.
No, they did.
I just took a...
This sounds good.
Let me tell you the story.
They went to court over it.
No.
I told you, Bijou Phillips was his girlfriend.
No, it's like I can't deal with...
life?
You want to make... You know, these kids are fucking talented. And you take them to a spot.
That's a ringing endorsement.
No, and and then all of a sudden it's like, no, we just want to do our own.
What are you talking about?
I don't know. It was fucked up.
What kid's talented? What happened? Dom, you tell it. This is Bob's wonderful son, Dom, who I hope gets out of the house.
You
should have went to Cleveland. Go ahead, Bob.
So what happened was that we had the band and some things started falling apart, and then it ended up my dad threatening to kill my guitar player father.
Why?
And then
that's what I do.
Over because
what?
That's what my dad just does. He just wakes up and he goes, "I'm
yeah,
just
I know, but
fuck
what,
up
what,
my
what,
day
what,
and...
what prompted it? What prompted?
I don't.
Did
remember.
Did he say he wrote the joke about whatever?
No.
I'm gonna beat my dick like it owes me money.
No. Yeah.
What happened? The guy had to do something.
He basically
was it money?
No, we argued. We just argued
about what?
We were arguing about bands.
He thought he was good at Jack Bruce, and you said John.
No, I said he's good at John Entwistle today.
Yeah,
like, I didn't
who's
say
better
years
in the
ago.
Band or
no, like, the problem
direction
was,
of the band.
Yeah, no, the problem was I said, you know, you don't make money being a cover band. You can be a tribute band.
Right, you don't want to be that. Well, because Rolling Stones, the first two albums were all like, you know, cover, and their manager very famously said, what you're saying, got to write your own songs.
Yeah, and he basically said to me, he goes, well, he's going to be a star. And I go, yeah, like you, because you're fucking 50-something and you're playing fucking bars. And I said, these kids can fucking go out there and rock as good as anyone.
Well, that's not a nice thing to say to somebody, though.
No, it was after years.
Developing a relationship.
After 2 years, sometimes guys fight. But the whole thing is...
And quite frankly, did he have a comeback for you?
No, of course not.
He said to my dad, he said he's going to shoot my dad's Jew head off.
Well, yeah, but dad on the phone. He did not say that to my face.
Well, you say you say you're not Jewish, though. Bob, what's wrong? Bob lies about that.
Am I? I don't.
You say you're not Jewish.
Levinsky, with the last name we found.
His mother, who's insane, told my new girlfriend, not only on the first time she meets her, that I jerk off in the bubble bath. Okay, his mother said
maybe
that.
Maybe you're not sure.
Okay, I jerk off in the bubble bath, and I tried to hit her with a chair, and she had to put Dom in her hands to stop it. This is what she's telling my new girlfriend.
She's obviously wishing you guys well.
Exactly, and he doesn't know that this is setup going on.
Was that the toast of the engagement?
Basically, yeah.
And then she came with the
I met this guy jerking off in a bubble bath.
Yeah, and then she said that my real name is Lewinsky, but we shorted it. We shortened the name when we came over here.
Well, you blew the president of the hair club for men.
That's the next thing she's going to say.
Then they Monica Lewinsky blew the president of the United States. You blew the president of the hair club for men.
Hey, it worked out good for both of us.
It looks great.
Also a member.
I'm not just an asshole. I'm also a member.
No, but everybody's happy again. You know, look, people right. have arguments.
It looks like you got a happy factory over there.
We do. I grow happiness every day.
A lot of happy people move to Cleveland.
Let me tell you, who can you get coming from California to Jersey? I did that, so that's a bigger.
Who was that?
My new girlfriend.
Really?
Damn. Yeah, she moved from California.
What part of California? Two strikes? Hey Bob, remember I met you at that gas station? Yeah, I got a second DUI. Can I move in?
No, she's brilliant. She's an unbelievable person.
Who's awesome. Smarter, Stephen Hawking?
Anyone compared to my dad is brilliant.
Stop it. Don't fucking be like that, you fuck. I could have fucking shot you out a window or made you into a sock baby. But listen, whole thing
sounds
is...
Sounds like a happy factory.
Yeah.
Yeah. But the whole thing is...
Silence
no.
of the lambs over there.
We
Dom,
have a
Dom,
good...
you realize you could make a lot of money on Dr. Phil.
No, he has it good. We have a good fucking time together.
Are you telling me that your father... said you could be made into a sock baby, which I assume means I don't run in those circles, but I assume means he would have ejaculated into a sock.
Oh man!
As a alternative to ejaculating into your mother's vagina, therefore making her pregnant with you. Is that what he meant by that?
That's well, let me tell you.
You're getting your own talk show, Dom.
Now, if it wasn't for him, forget about it. You know what I mean?
What are you talking about?
I don't know what I would do with her.
You'd have more money.
I'd have a lot of money. I mean, she probably got me for about $250,000, right? She definitely did.
Who did?
My ex-wife.
You had $250,000?
I had it. Yeah,
where
the house, the pool, the $5,000 a month for how many months?
Your house is how much?
Probably about $250,000 right now.
Bob, that's like the White House in Deptford.
We're talking Westville.
How big is it?
I'm the Duke of Deptford. No, I have built-in pool. I have everything. Basically,
you
I would
have
give
a
her
built-in pool.
Hey, I used to come home and when I won that competition for $25,000 on Stern, I didn't see a dime of that.
We still have the check in the ceiling in the basement. The water.
Yeah, which she'll probably sell on eBay. That fucking money hungry.
Wait
spot.
A minute, what competition? What?
You remember the meanest listener? Yeah. I won that, and I won all that money.
In the car.
In the car.
I thought you split it.
Nice.
I split it with Yucko. Yeah, but the whole thing is that I didn't see a dime in that because I bring home money. I don't give a fuck about
what
money.
What do you mean you didn't see a dime?
She took it all. She fucking started buying shit.
Who's she?
His mother.
Oh, his mother. Okay.
You know?
So do you like hearing your mother talking about Lewis?
No, he fucking loves it now. He wants to move in with me.
Is she the one in Cleveland?
No. I got plenty.
That's the other one he made happy.
Yeah, I chase
him. Bob, it sounds like you're doing great there.
Well, look, I get if you have a
sound busy.
Why don't you just lease out the built-in pool to a black family or something?
Well, we did when we booked ourselves in Florida that time.
Oh my God,
that was the most frightening I ever seen Artie look out at a pool. Like I go, they got a pool here, we can go swimming, and he looked there, and it looked like there was basically Snickers bars in the pool.
That's terrible.
No, but okay, explain it then.
That's terrible. I'm saying I got sold for a pack of Newports.
Okay, so he made it seem more nice.
Funnier.
Yes. Well, I was just explaining.
I told a funny joke. I went with that option. What? That's when Bob called me up. That's when I said, Bob, I think we can graduate the theaters. He goes, you want to do a fifth show at 2 p.m.?
That's when we moved on.
Like, what?
Yeah.
Five shows in a day? It's 11 o'clock at brunch. I'm drunk.
We were always drunk at that time.
You actually pitched to me four drunks, and the guy, we never told this on the podcast, the guy Don who ran the place had such a bad speech impediment. he was the announcer for the night show.
It was either him or John.
All right, okay, he talked to me. John, Listen, it says a Brunson. The tickets are selling. We got to get Brunson. You heard every other fourth word.
Yeah.
So he would say something like this. Your mother called from Jersey because of cancer. What? Your sister called from Jersey because of car because they had an accident. Huh? Your grandfather called the office. Kappa said the tickets were coma.
I'd have like to have him write coma? It down. Yeah.
Bob Carr wants to do a fifth show that Jewish.
Was he the MC too or no?
No, just, no.
He owned the place. He would announce you. Yeah. Welcome to Boca Raton. Boca Raton's premier at Boca Raton.
Please turn on all your phone calls, all your phones, and keep on running noise. And
Bob's on stage.
Wow.
Gosh, it's a fuck talent for got overpaid. Casey's on stage selling drugs and said, what's order of restraint.
And then a brawl broke out after the show.
The guy was in our face, and he wouldn't get out of our face. He claimed he was in the mafia.
So I hit him.
Oh, shit.
No, I looked away for 2 seconds, and I saw Bob's ass and the guy's face going over a couch.
Yes.
Listen. Listen. Bob Mafia's guys fighting against that consigliere. What?
I understood him. He meant.
What happened?
We had a sit down the next
Listen,
day.
Listen, about paying for the gig. Pay for the gig, sad, bankrupt. That check, sad, in the mail, counting.
We had no idea. He would say that Artie, he was trying to tell me that we
I had to do an hour, 5 fucking shows. And what are you talking about? And the morning that we flew down from the Boca Raton, morning at 6 a.m., I was on the fucking radio.
I know.
Oh, and those fucking Boca Raton audiences, they would have flip-flops on. I would scream at them in the front row. They all had money for some reason. You don't know why.
The chicks were hot.
Like their father invented the zipper or something.
Yeah. The chicks were hot guys were ugly.
Oh, yeah. And they go, come to my hot tub. Who's going to be in the hot tub? My wife, Veronica. Hi. And then her friend, Tammy. Yeah, that sounds good so far. And then me and my friend, Timmy. That's where you lose me. Bye.
That's how you met Tim?
Go to your hot tub. Yeah. Shot Timmy's on phone. Shot's not short. Timmy driving here, South Range Rover, can't reach wheel.
Remember the picture I took of him? It looked like a kid driving the truck when he took us to that gig. And I sent it on Twitter. I took a picture of Tim from behind.
What happened?
I took the picture of Tim from behind driving, and I said, my son is driving us to the gig, and people actually thought it was my son because it looked like a child. Everything's fine.
Tim was very short.
He still is.
Yeah.
He didn't grow.
He didn't get that growth spurt late in life.
Black comics, extra bone ankle.
Oh, no.
Listen, Chad Greg Geraldo, Chad Dad, Chad, can you Chad substitute? Tell him he's Greg Geraldo, Dad substitute.
It was like a cartoon.
Well, no,
character.
Big Al Martin bought it.
Yeah.
Big Al Martin had one of those guns. Like Roger Ailes. Yeah. Like he just let Gunther come over. Like,
oh, no.
And he wears shirt in his pants. I'm like, how are you doing that? How you doing? Like the fucking guys on the Nets wear their shirt out. Allen Iverson wears his shirt out. This guy's got a fucking 800-pound belly.
Damn.
Remember Big Al?
Yeah.
And the real guy's guy, he told old jokes, but he was great on stage. He had great timing, Al Martin. But he told old jokes. But great old jokes, like... Well, the joke's not old to be here for the first time. The first time I ever heard this joke was Al Martin on stage, 1992. He said, the cops repossessed it for auction. My car, I had $3,000 in parking tickets, and I went to the auction and bought my car back for $200. Which was a great scam. Yeah, but he introduced everybody, Big Al, because he had the New York Comedy Club. That was where, on 2nd Avenue and 49th Street, in 1992, that's where it was. It was above a Korean deli. And I asked the Korean guy, I got my first headshots ever. I paid his cokehead $30 in Edison. He kept going in the bathroom. He came back out here. We go, you want a piece of construction paper in the back? pick a color. I go, blue. We're out of blue. I go, what do you have? He goes, I have white. That's it. and he took the picture. They were so terrible. Terrible. And I said to the Korean deli guy, I was drunk, I said, can you put this in your window next to, like, the soup? And I swear to God, I kept going back for 2 years. It was up in the
nice.
They never, and the same cans of soup. Disgusting. Next to the mushroom, creamy mushroom.
Oof.
I was about to go on stage, do a 20-minute set. Most impressive thing I've ever done in a comedy club. I step on a nail that's coming out of a 2x4. They were renovating.
Wow.
Okay.
It goes through your shoe?
Goes through my shoe, fuck. Into my foot.
Ouch.
I pull it out, and there's blood on the nail. And I hadn't had a tetanus shot in a while. I said, I got to go to the hospital. But I had to do a set. And I said, I'm doing the set. Jimmy Palumbo was there. I said, I'm doing it. Because I have to do this. I have to become a comedian. Otherwise, it'll be this is my life. I'll be in this corner for the rest of my life. With my headshot next to the soup. So I went up. I did a 20-minute set. Destroyed. I was so angry. It's the best I had done in stand-up to that day. I was 23 years old. I got off stage bleeding and limping. I said to Big Al Martin, I said, $20 was the fee. I said, you got to give me $20. I need a cab. He gave me the $20. I spent $14 on a cab. I went into St. Vincent's, the old St. Vincent's,
yep.
Right in the heart of Greenwich Village, right by Gay Street, in the middle of Gay Town.
Yep.
You know what that emergency room looked like on a Friday night at midnight?
Oh.
Doctor, is Dr. Abernathy here? I've been waiting for like 18 hours. My friend Daniel is in there. Well, he might be Danielle. What time is it? It's 2 a.m. He's Daniel. He's Daniel. Is this a Friday? No, he's still Danielle. I'm sorry. If this were Wednesday, he'd be Daniel, right? Talking to a fucking doctor who's had an attitude of like he just was over it. Like every doctor there was over it.
Mm-hmm.
And wearing like hazmat suits because AIDS and stuff. Like they were
yeah,
scared of everything.
Huge, yeah.
Yeah. AIDS was big. Like the WHO. They were big.
So real popular that year.
Excuse me. I'm waiting for the ultimate operation. And I need to get blood tests. Where's the dialysis machine? Can I have it? Can I take it home and do this? People had no idea what they were talking about. And can I get some propofol? You need a prescription and you need to have an operation. You mean to tell me I need to have an operation to get propofol? Can you give me just a drop of it? And so I went in there and I waited, and the guy stitched something, gave me a tetanus shot, mm-hmm. gave me medication, antibiotics, stitched something. I had like 2 stitches in my foot.
Youch.
And I leave there. I had no insurance. So they said, well, mail you a bill. It was $2,400. I just paid it off last week.
It's ridiculous.
I had $20 around Martin. So $14 in the cab. I came into the city with $8, not lying. Palumbo used to yell at me. He goes, Art, we're about to go into the biggest metropolis on the planet to perform. You have $8. He would go, like, Art, it's 1992. I insist in 1993, as a goal, you get some sort of relationship with the bank. There was times I had no money. I would have to, on the train ride home, I was in the bathroom hiding from the conductor. He goes, Art, what are you doing? You're in the thick of your mother. If you saw this, you're in the bathroom pretending to shit. You shit through Rawway. I would miss my stop because I would pretend to shit, and Jimmy would have to drive me home.
Can you get me in Piscataway?
Yeah, that's what happened. I'm not going to shit through Piscataway. I thought I was getting over on the same conductor every time, and then like 3 weeks in, the guy was retiring, and he said that Jimmy liked the guy. Anyway, he said to Jimmy, I'm retired. I got my 20 years. And Jimmy goes, oh, that's great. I hear this conversation going on. I'm pretending you shit. And the guy walks up to the thing, and he knocks on the bathroom door. He goes, hey in there, buddy. I'm retiring. He knew the whole time.
You can come out now.
He knew the whole time. And Jimmy said, you knew it? He goes, you think I'm going to do paperwork for him?
Amazing.
Paperwork.
That's amazing.
Hey, buddy, I'm retiring. He had a drink, a beer at the bar with Jimmy, and Jimmy said, he goes, yeah, I told your buddy in there, because I don't give a fuck. I'm like an old school guy, but there's a young colored guy coming out. He's buying a book.
He ain't going to fall for his shit.
Colored guy coming out, he's buying the book. It's fucking hilarious. That guy should have a development deal. Listen, Lucky Bastard is a book. In the last... Bob, again.
I'm sorry.
That was so disgusting.
Yeah, it hurts.
Bob, what is that? It sounds like a mouse covered in mayonnaise is jumping in a pool.
I don't know.
A mouse in Russian dressing is jumping in a pool. Why? Yeah, that's disgusting.
I drink like that. I don't know why. I'm sorry. I won't do it again.
Yeah, no, but that is gross. Right up to the mic.
I didn't try.
Oh, it's going to be... We have to change that mic.
No, I didn't get it on.
You're like Michael Winslow. He's the guy who did all the, guy did all the sound effects of Police Academy. He did stand up, but following him, you'd be like, yo, you have hepatitis C from the mic. I have sickle cell anemia from the microphone.
Hey, you sound like an airplane.
I've led such a chaotic, ridiculous life that now I'm at the level at 49 where people are writing books and loser shit I've done are in the books. In the last 60 days, two books have come out where Norm Macdonald wrote a book, and my chapter was about how I almost didn't get in the biggest movie of my life because I was on cocaine at the audition. And bought cocaine from Mexicans at the audition in front of him and Bob Saget. Got high in the bathroom, came out in a blackout, thought I lost the job. And Norm called me up and said, now I'm going to give it to you, man. Wow. He goes, I like losers. What can I tell you? He goes, just don't bring any shit over the border. We had to go to Toronto.
Yeah.
That was that. And now I'm in Joe Buck's book. And, of course, talking about the time I ruined his life on live HBO.
That's amazing.
But, got the show canceled.
No, I didn't. More or less. I didn't. And he tells in here how I didn't. It wasn't my fault. The show had Chad Ochocinco, a man who changed his name to his football jersey number, Ochocinco. Mm-hmm. He was supposed to announce something. He sat there like an oil painting. It was so boring. And then Brett Favre, a fucking redneck boar, was supposed to announce coming back into the league. Nothing. It was just, Joe was doing a good job, but at the end it was me, Jason Sudeikis, who I didn't know Jason Sudeikis was at the time. I was with this woman. Well, whatever. And he was with that January Jones chick. And I said, who's that guy with January Jones? And they go, he's on Saturday Night Live. I didn't even know. I didn't know he was. A little arrogant, whatever. A little Northwestern for my liking. Good guy. Yeah, good guy. And I think he came up with the concept for We're the Millers that night. So it was him and Paul Rudd. Paul Rudd is a guy, he went to high school with Joe Buck. They're from Kansas. And so I was the only stand-up there. If there's a live audience of stand-up, you have an advantage because you're used to it. I hate people who think I was trying to fuck with Joe. I wasn't. He's a good guy. I was trying to make the show funny. Backstage, he said, come at me, man. Just come at me. You can roast me. The executive producer said, yeah, you're our comic, man. Go nuts. He said, go nuts. So, and it's HBO. Let's take this car out. See what's got under the hood, baby. And Paul's the other guy. So he goes to Paul. Again, Paul's not a stand-up. And he says to Paul, they're reminiscing about Kansas and... And he goes, I saw you on TMZ or something. TMZ. And then Joe said TMZ is my favorite website. And it was dying on a vine. It was being boring. So he said to me, Artie, hoping to find laughs. I could see. It was live television. We're on HBO.
Yep.
I had crushed 9 Vicodin to Jack Daniels about 10 minutes before. I wish I was joking. And, I thought it was 1972 on The Tonight Show with Dean Martin and George Gobel. I was trying to light a cigarette.
An issue.
Those were the days. Yeah, of course.
That was funny.
I should have went on an ascot like fucking Johnny Carson. So I said, TMZ's your favorite website. That's fruity. I said, what's your second favorite? Suckingdick.com? Okay. Gets a roar of laughter. Roar into an applause break. For like 5 minutes. It was so long, the applause break, Jason Sudeikis had to address it. He went, yeah! He knew what it was like to get a reaction. So, and then I riff for about 5 minutes, and I'm killing. I'm a comic. I'm getting, you know, energy from the audience I'm killing. But I didn't realize that it's all bashing the guy who hosts the show. And I noticed his four-year-old daughter was 10 feet from us. I don't know, it was a family thing. Smoking hot wife, by the way. And Mike Lerman was in the crowd. I may or may not have made some racial jokes. I may have said, Michael, I smell dick. Did you burp about the old thing? But so the crowd's loving it. But then they were a little, they thought, of course, like crowds nowadays, I was being a little too mean. Artie was being mean to the multimillionaire sports announcer. Sorry. I can't get up my sympathy for him. And then I ended with a great impression of his dad. And they loved that. And that was a tribute to his dad, Jack Buck. I love his fucking dad. He's a man's man. And he was forced to do shitty network promos that were gay. And you could tell he didn't like doing it. He wanted to announce the fucking game. Okay. This is how Jack Buck, his father, took. All right. Two out, second and third. There'll be a pitching change. Tonight on CBS, 60 Minutes. And followed by Alice and a show called Jake and the Fat Man. I'm looking at the description. Apparently, it's a fella named Jake and a heavy set guy, I guess. I guess the guy's heavy set. And they solve crimes. Followed by news. Second and third. There we go. Tonight, 10 o'clock, the CBS Sunday movie. I want my kid back, the Jessica Connor story. Meredith Baxter, Bernie, and Sally Field. Star. And what's his face? Kyle Armstrong. Lance Armstrong. The guy from the Cal Burnett show. And yeah, Meredith Baxter, Bernie. And, of course, that's followed by the CBS local news with Dan Rather, who's looking a bit fruity these days. I love Danny. I'm just busting his chops. Two outs.
Leading off second.
Yeah. He would do like, he'd do segues like, Jake and the Fat Man. Speaking of fat, John Crook is up. Apparently, he said, apparently a heavy set fella. I don't know these titles nowadays. A heavy set fella. Tonight on Magnum PI, Tom Selleck gets laid again. I guess. He had a great, he would say with Tim McCarver, you go, here we go. First pitch. Magnum Aromatics wheels, deals, rocks, kicks the offering. It's a fly ball out to Bonds. He's there. He's got it. That's the way this one starts. McCarver will give you the lineups. So I did a tribute to him. And I tried to light a cigarette. Apparently they thought I was doing that because he died of throat cancer. I would never do that.
Oh, come on. You see how people
I found
think.
That the first time in this book, Joe.
Are you serious?
If you let Joe be a guest to it, I'm going to say, Joe, I never knew that. He said, that's the only thing that got me mad. But Joe did the coolest thing. So I leave there. Paul Rudd, I swear, this is what happened. Paul Rudd leaned into me and said, and I quote, and he has confirmed this on radio. He said, Art, well, you realize you just did a legendary thing. That's the greatest thing I've ever seen. You're a legend because the place is going on live TV. He goes, you saved the show. Paul Rudd said that to me. I go, thanks, man. The whole audience is laughing, blah, blah, blah. I did all right with the broad.
And that thing went on after the show was over. There was like extra show.
I'll tell you what happened.
Then it got
that's where it was terrible.
Yeah.
I kept being mean on the internet. I don't have any respect for the internet. And it was a lot of awkward silence. Because I was being very mean. But I wasn't trying to be mean. I might have said the N-word. Anyway, Michael Irvin got mad at that. And I got into Michael Irvin's face on his radio show. The prick. He had my bio in front of Michael Irvin. He wasn't dealing with some scared fucking wide receiver. He goes, hey, I got your bio. Did you rob a bank? It says you robbed a bank. I go, no, I didn't rob a bank. You're wrong. He goes, no, you're wrong. He goes, well, I'm reading your bio. I go, I have your bio, Mike. Did you do coke off a whore's ass and punch her in the face? Okay. And there's a long pause. And the engineer who was with me, Scott the engineer, is like, there's a long pause. And then he goes, I never hit no lady.
That's amazing.
He's going, what did I do? I did the coke, sure. Sure. Yeah. I never hit no lady. I go, fine. Are we on the same page then? You want to keep reading my bio? You're not exactly Pat Boone. The White House is familiar? Jerry Jones, huh? That's, you and Emmett Smith and some lube?
Man.
Anyway. Yeah, no, he knew he was fucking around. Yeah, yeah. I said, you're not dealing with a guy who fucking does segment producing for The View. And we're friends now, Michael Irvin. Remember Michael Irvin called? Remember my, yes. He called in? He goes, I like him. He's my man, man. I'm his man, man.
See, that's cool.
That I know what that means. I'm his man, man.
That's good.
So I walk out of there thinking everything's great. Everything's great. We dropped the girl off. My cock was stuck to my pants. I showered. And I go to the Stern Show thinking this is going to be great. I saved his show on HBO. No, this is Artie Lang we're talking about. It's my life.
It don't work that way.
It don't work like that in here. It don't work. So I go there, and Howard goes, how was that thing last night? And Howard has that evil giggle. I'm like, what are you talking about? I go, I did great. He goes, really? He goes, you see the New York Post? I go, no. He goes, I won't talk about it on the air. Big headline, Artie Lang banned from HBO. I got banned. Howard said, dude, this is the greatest thing ever. You know how many books that's going to sell? And he goes, you're like an outlaw. Fuck them. He goes, yeah. I go, first of all, I'm banned from HBO Sports. That's really going to cut into my income. you know, and Bucks. So I'm banned from HBO Sports. The ban lasted 30 minutes. Joe Buck called me up the next day and said, you're on the next show. Because of ratings. We did a cold open, and I was on the next show. People don't realize that. And it got a bunch of laughs. That guy, I'm not the reason it went away. The reason it went away is because they were trying to, the funny people on the show were defensive backs.
Yeah, exactly.
their comedians were middle linebackers. And Sudeikis and Rudd gave them nothing. People and Paul Rudd are reminiscing about, you know, not playing sports in Kansas.
Yeah, it was weird. It was a really weird mix.
Yeah.
And he didn't have the, I don't know, he just didn't really have it.
Look, he's a good guy. He's a friend of mine, and he was great at the monologue. He was good. They should have kept him. Instead, they hired this Bill Simmons guy. That just got canceled, thank God. Did you see that?
That was terrible. No.
Terrible ain't even the word. I'm watching it going, well, how is this on television?
Yeah.
This is on television.
You're paying this man to do this.
Right. You go to fucking, go to Yuck Yucks in Toronto. Throw a rock at the green room. You will hit somebody more entertaining than Bill Simmons.
Yeah, for sure.
Sort of at the audience you'll hit.
That's so. What I mean. You know how many people are pissed? Yeah. You're the funny. You, how many times have you been voted the funniest guy in Deptford?
Every year. I'm the only one that votes. But
I mean, if Bill Simmons has a show, Levy should have 10 shows.
Should have 50.
Right. Well, you're personal demons.
My personal demons.
Well, you know, you sent a videotape where you say cunt a lot to Letterman with your own scrawl saying I could clean this up.
It can be cleaned up for TV.
I don't know who was advising you there. Who was your manager telling you to do that? Was it Mickey McSuckberg?
I think Otto and George told me to write that.
He was some sort of genius.
He was.
I bought cocaine in Buffalo with him and the dummy.
That's the funny thing when go, the puppet's always with him.
Well, he took it with him to buy drugs.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I said, wow. I have to go with you. And yeah. this guy, or, you know.
That's amazing. Does he make the puppet buy?
Well, the puppet's with
but
us.
He can't get arrested.
The puppet's with us.
The puppet did it.
The puppet holds the money.
Yeah, the puppet.
Shut
I got
up.
So, okay, the dealer, we're dealing with this dealer in Buffalo who may or may not have been African American. And he said, what's in the box? He was scared to death.
Probably thought it was a gun.
He was scared to death.
Like a gun.
He almost dropped a spear out of his
hand. A gun? What is it, like a fucking cannon? What's in the box? Glad you asked that, Tyrone. Do you like comedy? Do you know where Giggles is? Tyrone, you are on the Artie Lang Show. We'll take that eight ball from you and we'll get going.
Yeah, but he always had the puppet with him. So whether you're doing drugs, the puppet is there. You're doing coke.
Well, fucking Jerry Seinfeld stole my idea. I would call that comedians in cars getting cocaine.
Yeah. That would be so
way
fun.
More entertaining. Way more entertaining.
Absolutely.
It was, yeah. Ellen DeGeneres ain't on that one.
Yeah.
Oh, jeez.
She was on comedians in cars getting pussy, though.
Should have brought coke. It might help.
Hey, well, that always helps. That's how she dances.
Does that piss you off that she gets more pussy than you?
Well, than everybody.
And yeah, basically everybody.
Portia de Rosa looks dazed. She's had her face shoved in that pussy for 5 years. Why do you think Anne Heche was walking around in the days for a while? Knocking on doors. It wasn't ecstasy. I've had my face in Ellen DeGeneres' pussy for 5 years.
Can you get these flies off my face?
Please? Please?
It's like a PTSD.
You yeah. smell like pussy and unfunny.
Yeah. You dated Ellen, yeah. haven't you?
You smell like pussy and no talent.
Can you do the dance?
Can you imagine the world we're living in? She gets Emmy Awards, she dances.
Yeah.
She dances.
What did your friend call pussy again? Knicks?
Skus.
Skus. Oh, my God.
He had a shirt called Hey Bitch.
Skus.
Hey Bitch, show us. Not even we. It was nice
show
of us.
Like, your skus.
Including his friends.
Yeah.
Hey Bitch, show us your skus. Which means he's probably been involved in a lot of rapes. Like, he's probably attended rapes.
Yeah.
Mm. Show us your skus.
Oh, man.
Actually, he's not demanding it. That you, I had another shirt actually that said you better show us your skirt.
Yeah. He wore that Saturday. Saturdays.
He never wore that on weekends.
Friday night is just a request.
Yeah.
Saturday night it's an order.
It is.
We should have a all scumbag spelling bee. Skirt. Bob, you skus in a sentence.
We have breaking news.
What?
Ellen DeGeneres to receive the Presidential Medal of Freedom.
For what?
For a talk show.
Free portion of the ration from her pussy? Could you imagine the world we're living in? Could you imagine?
This is
if she if she didn't announce she was gay at the right time, Ellen DeGeneres would be working at a gift shop at Los Angeles Airport.
Selling those Walmart cards.
Hey, hey, do you want another keychain? You want to see me dance? No. No. And her girlfriend would look like me.
See, that's what money does.
Of course it does. Portia Ross, so fucking, I imagine if she was just a fucking broke comic. David Spade was so funny. He worked with her like years and years ago at the Dallas Improv. He was telling me the story. He goes, yeah, I was hitting on her all weekend and nothing happened. And then a couple of weeks later, some of my friend at the Improv told me the news. I said to him, Spade, look how arrogant you are. Yeah, she's not fucking you. She must be a lesbian. Maybe she has eyesight. He would say stuff like, oh, you're funny.
Yeah, yeah.
That's funny. That's funny stuff. The first time I texted Spade and I put LOL. This was so fucking funny. I put LOL next to it. Like, that's what you do. I was used to text him with broads. Some broad taught me how to text. I put LOL. He texted back, first of all, I'll tell you when something's funny.
That's awesome.
I'm not a cheerleader you're trying to make out with. Anyway, Joe's book is Lucky Bastard. There's a whole chapter on me. And again, he was very nice to me. He's honest in the book. You know, I was on drugs that night. That's what happens. You say sucking dick in front of Joe Buck's daughter. His daughters are so hot, and his first wife is so hot. God bless this guy. Look at this. Talk about pissing you off. Every look at this. Oh, there's Jack Buck. See,
even he's hot.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm hot. This is Jack Hot Buck. Yeah.
I can feel the clear stuff coming up.
Yeah, I'm like Donald Trump. I'm going to buy you some furniture and grab your pussy. This is Jack Buck. I'm with Billy Bush. And we're me, Billy Bush, and Donald Trump are going to grab some pussy and buy some furniture.
Stealing home.
Would you like me to stain your furniture? I can stain your furniture. Look at the picture of me and Jack Buck's daughter. You think he did my DirecTV show? I'm in the book. I look like a corpse. I look like a fat guy who escaped from a mental institution. And she is so fucking hot, man. She is hot as hell.
Joe did the intro to Crash and Burn.
And he wrote the right.
Yeah,
Joe,
very funny one.
Joe nice. Wrote a great forward to Crash and Burn. Anyway, the Hannity thing I wanted to tell you. This fucking broad. Ainsley, who wrote the littlest cunt.
Dad's Prayers.
Yeah, Daddy's Prayers. Mm-hmm. Daddy's Prayers. And then she had her father on. Her father was real, like, Southern, had that accent, like a real rich, ultra-white Southern guy.
Right.
And he's probably not a racist, but he had that accent, like racist shit would just flow off the tongue. Like, the nigger hordes are coming, and we're getting prepared for that. And, I had the first, the original title of the book was Killing Faggots. Ainsley thought that might cost her a job, and I said, oh, those fucking pussies up in New York City. Well, I call Jews bearded New Yorkers, you know. I said, those bearded New Yorkers up there, motherfuckers, and moon cricket lovers, I call blacks moon crickets. Which is a nice, I think it's a nice name, better than nigger. I use nigger for the table. And she knows, you know, I put out prayers. And, yeah. You know, a prayer we'd say at church, or a little sermon. So it has the N-word in it. What's the matter with that? This is, I'm teaching her. I love the fact she married a pure white man, has a pure white baby. That's all I care about. Now, Ainsley, go ahead, try to sell this book. Well, anyway, thank you, Dad. The Jews at CAA said to me, she's got Jew agents. I told her, get a Jew agent. And I met her team at CAA. That is rude. I said, let's avoid traffic. Let's go up to CAA at Rosh Hashanah. And the Hispanic driver at the Hispanic janitor, it was Christmas time, and I got a chance to wish him Fellas Nevada. I said, Fellas Nevada, who's Fellas Nevada? Senor, you mean Feliz Navidad? Yeah, Fellas Nevada. And I get the car. Happy Ramadan. Where's the cab driver? Happy Ramadan. Happy Kwanzaa. Where's Brad Gumble? Happy Kwanzaa. He doesn't work here. He's on television on another network. Well, if you see him, happy Kwanzaa. Do you see him at the TV meetings? But, yes, very, very pretty. Very, very pretty Joe Buckstorner. She doesn't look afraid. I was going to say, so she says to Hannity, you, I'm going to make me and Anthony feel very good right now. Bob, I'm going to speak Italian to Anthony. Okay. Tu papa, benzavanti. I'm the hunted one. Now, she says to Sean Hannity, you are the king of bestsellers, Sean. How many bestsellers do you have? I've written 3 books. I have 2 bestsellers. Wow. Okay. Me and Anthony. 2 bestsellers. 2 for 2.
2 for 2, yeah. Baby.
So I guess we're Sean Hannity. Hey, Ainsley, suck our dicks. Fuck Sean Hannity. His 3rd one didn't make it. That salt and pepper Republican prick. We're writing our 3rd one. We're writing our 3rd one.
Yep.
I attacked life, honey. 2 bestsellers about my life before the age of 50. I'm in 3 books. I'm, you know, I look like a loser in all of them, but that's beside the point.
Not the ones I write.
Right. I'm going to be in Bob's book, which, of course, will come out in 70 years.
After the death.
Well, you better hope, you know, someone marries like someone who can write in your family. Bob wants you to write his book, Aaron.
Oh, no, we talked.
You did talk. I said, do you want it? He wants you to, you said to me, well, Anthony, write your book. I asked Anthony, and he just stopped laughing.
About two.
What is going to be in your book? What's the big rumor? Because I asked Stutter and John. John wants to write a book about Howard. I said,
no, I don't. I want to write about
I said, don't write about Howard, John. Because
everybody knows about what happened.
I said, first of all, Howard has no... I'll say this. Howard has no smoking gun. He never cheated on his wife. I never saw it. There's no money issues. He lives a good life. There's no excitement there.
Fucking Ralph isn't...
If you had tape of that, that's a book. That's a documentary.
I'm kidding.
But I said, John, what are the stories? He goes, oh, about the time... What about the time I threw up outside his house? I go, what, Bob? What, John? Threw up outside his house? I go, where are you going to plug it? You're not on the Stern Show anymore. when you went to the bathroom, your podcast would lose half its listeners. Adam Carolla threw him off his podcast that way after 3 shows.
Really?
Well, John says he quit. Because a lot of people quit after 3 shows. Yeah, Adam Carolla put him on his podcast.
Yeah, I know that.
Yeah, yeah.
That's
not on anymore.
That's a huge podcast. There's a lot of... Well,
that was like the first real big one.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yep.
Wow.
And I guess an executive decision was made.
Three shows. That's a...
My favorite John story.
It's a life cycle.
He paid for a gig. It was a gig he was paying us. Bob, I don't think you were on this. And John gets us a JetBlue. No first class, JetBlue. And... I get 1 little meal because it's in L.A. and I'm starving and I'm trying to eat it. And it's when John had the real long hair. John falls asleep. His hair is in my food.
No.
falls asleep. I can't wake him up. Oh. And his fingernails are filthy. He stinks. He had flip-flops on.
They was stuck. He popping pills or anything? Or
I don't know what he was doing.
Something?
I don't know. I have to call my lawyer. No, you know, he would come to work in pajamas. And he would fall asleep with dirty fingernails. And he would wake up over, like, Denver. And I'd have hair in my eggs. Oh. And I go, John, did you? He's half Puerto Rican, half Danish. I said, did you get any of the Danish?
He got all of yours.
Did you get any of the? And he goes, well, put me in there. It's funny, honey. We're telling the air. Hey, can I tell a story about the time you fucked that midget on the air? I got a piss. Let's take a break. Ready?
Ready.
We're back. Artie Quitter podcast. Seamless edit. And we're back.
Yes.
Jumping in. Dan is wearing a Cub hat. Dan, why don't you wear a regular Cubs hat? That looks like a retard. Like a retarded guy wears. Like, I like Cubs.
No, it looks like he made it. The retarded guy made it because it doesn't look like the hat, actually.
Well, you know, it's like a big, it's an, a C very is extra big C.
Yeah.
Like, you know, why get the regular one?
I'll get the regular one.
It looks like you took it off a jersey.
I wore for Bob.
Yeah, well, I'm saying, well, yeah, where did you buy that?
It was the spring training cap.
Did you use a coupon?
No.
It's like for the visually impaired.
We know retarded guys wear like orange socks and a Met jacket and like a
flannel shirt.
Yeah.
Safety vests.
Right. Yeah. Exactly. Like the stand-ins for Duck Dynasty. Not Duck Dynasty. They're smart. The stand-ins.
Yeah.
And, you know, and then they have a hat with an extra big C on it. I wear a hat. I like a hat. I like hot dog a game.
Let's just keep my head warm.
I eat my feces. Oh, Reese's feces. Oh. I like Reese's feces. I make commercial. Hey, your feces is in my peanut butter.
You got me. Your feces is in my peanut
butter. Your peanut butter is in my feces. Reese's feces.
Two great pastes that go great together.
Two great tastes. Great together. Hey, your feces is in my Cub hat. Your Cub hat is in my feces.
It doesn't look like a Cub hat, but it looks like it's
an enormous C.
And then the
bear in the middle.
Yeah.
Yeah, well, Cubs, yeah. I don't know. I don't like it.
Dom, you know who he is?
Him, right there?
Yeah, that's Dan Filato.
Yeah.
Well, he knows. He's met him before.
Only like 100 times.
Oh, okay.
It almost looks like it could be Chicago Bear. I mean, like,
well,
the
no, it's
football.
Like, it's, yeah. They start, what ha- here's what happens with these fucking hats, man. They do it with every team. Like, the Yankees have a lavender Yankee hat. Now.
Yeah.
It's to make money.
They put it out there,
like, you know, the girls go, let me have a lavender hat.
Mm-hmm.
Whatever.
And you drop $90 on a fucking lavender.
Yep.
You know what I'm saying? That's what they want. They want fucking, so they put out the Cub hat with the big C. And then
that's like the hat if they lost the World Series that some country would be
for 108 years.
You know, fucking little kids with flies on them would be wearing those hats.
That C stands for Canada. Canadian bear.
Canadian.
I like bear feces. I have seen the tickets, Cubs. I like Cubs. I like bears. I like bears, Cubs.
See, bears.
I like bulls.
Chickens.
I like chickens. I like eggs on my feces.
Oh, no.
Can I get my shit to go?
I'm going to ask for my very best girl's hand in marriage. Will you marry me? Why? You're moving to Cleveland? Why? Huh?
She did it, Tom.
You don't want to buy my son shoes? He'll wear flip-flops.
In the snow, though?
Well, I told you he sounds like John Entwistle. I meant singing. Jack Bruce.
Hey, play him.
So you really opened up for Jack Bruce. Now, he died before fucking Ginger Baker. How about that?
Yeah. But he was so nice.
I watch the Colbert Show with the sound off. It's so much better.
Yeah. It's actually funny.
I want to see the top 10 list tonight.
No, they don't do it.
Right now he's going over the articles in the Washington Post. That's hitting a middle America blue collar. He's going to raise the ratings. He's mentioning op-ed pieces in the Washington Post.
Pulling in those flyover states.
And then on the right, exactly. Yeah. And then on the editorial page, we're going to hit him hard with some Sarah Palin jokes. That's going to go good. So Bob, what's going on? You got Dom is doing gigs. What kind of gigs are you doing? Just music? Are you still doing your stand up? Dom?
He's basic.
What are your gigs? You have to play.
Dom does comedy too?
Yeah, he does. Yeah, absolutely.
Right on.
Yeah, I do. I'm playing with bands mostly right now. This Saturday, I'm playing at Southwood Bar and Grill in Woodbury, New Jersey.
Oh, that's good.
It's you know, I'm playing with the Billy the Kid Band, and it's going to be a good night.
I'm the Billy the Kid Band. We're the Billy the Kid Band.
Can I get Billy's liver?
No, need a liver. Dominic Levy's opening. Bob Levy's home. He sounds like John Entwistle. Eating blue cheese out of a chick's ass. Oh, man. If John Hunt was to lay blue cheese out of a chick's ass, need blue cheese. Now, what is this? Oh, I have to hear this. They're doing animated
it's
Trump.
A cartoon.
Oh, it's Trump and Putin.
Then that's cartoon Vladimir Putin. What? I had no idea he was sitting there, and therefore I am shocked.
Hello, Steven. Thank you for having me on Decadent Television Circus.
Well, Mr. Cartoon Putin, it's being reported that you...
This is Colbert interviewing a cartoon Trump and a cartoon Putin.
What reporters are saying is, give me names, I will fix.
This is worse than waterboarding.
That is totally ridiculous. We're working together for the betterment of both our countries. I've agreed to work with him on Syria. And in return, I've agreed to call him cool guy.
Yeah.
You know, what can I say? I'm a negotiator.
Oh, okay, but look, cartoon the dome. How can the next president of the United States embrace a leader who kills journalists and jails political opponents?
I don't do that. Do I? I don't. Those reports are lies, and...
This is Colbert trying to get Trump a second term.
Yeah.
You just got that answer from him.
Well, no, we're just good friends. We're so close.
People in Missouri are thinking they're watching the Fallon Show. Hey, when's he going to play ping pong with her? When's he playing ping pong with Susan Sarandon?
Speaking of temperature, Steven, your studio's been...
Who the fuck is Vladimir Putin?
Oh, I'm sorry. I have revealed my powerful abs and heaving slavic mandibles.
I'm watching Colbert. Need a writer.
Need a writer. Right? People wrote that and said, this is a good idea.
Absolutely. I got to kill Dwight Yoakam again. Get me a lawnmower. I'm going to kill Dwight Yoakam. I'm going to kill Garth Brooks. I got friends in low places. So are you gigging every weekend?
What kind of band is it? Who's Billy
the Kid Band? They play classic rock. I mean, I'm telling you.
Covers and stuff?
They are very good.
Nice.
Yeah.
But are you going to write originals? Are you writing more original songs?
Yeah, I'm writing a lot more now. I mean, I wrote the one song for the vets, The Fight Has Just Begun, and I keep writing and all that, and I was working on something before I came out here. I had the guitar, and I was playing some stuff, and came up with some ideas.
Well, yeah, I mean, you know, it takes a while for a hit song, man. I don't know how people do that. I really, as a musical talent, I cannot relate to that, you know. And how's it going with the vet thing, with the raising money for the vets?
It's good, you know, with the money that me and you did from that show.
Right.
We got some vet was getting a job. He wanted to work on Jet Airline, you know, on the engines again.
Right.
Okay, like he did over there.
Right.
But
we did over where?
when he was, you know, overseas fighting.
He worked on jet air. He repaired.
He repaired them.
Right.
Okay, and
I
he
hope
was
he's good at. I hope he's good at that.
Well, yes, he's very good at that.
That's not one. That's a job you can't mail in, man.
Oh yeah, exactly. So, but the whole thing was, you know,
one of the people in that crowd at Scranton repaired jet engines.
No. One of the people that hit me up. I get hit up every day by people. Okay,
right.
And they needed. He ended up getting a job, but they had no money to get an apartment.
Right.
So we put up 2 months pay so they can live.
Right.
And you know, they were basically letting their kids eat
but
their
but
food.
But the problem is, what about the third month? What do they do then?
Oh, he's got a job. He's got his
oh,
job.
He got a job.
And they want to give back to the Warrior Point so we can
well,
help somebody
sure, well,
else.
I'll make sure they, you know.
No, but that's their thing. They said that we don't want no money back,
well,
and that's
I don't
what
know
it
what,
is. And the whole
we thing, don't want no money back.
No, we want to help all the vets out there. I work with Uncle Sam's
so
children.
That, with the proceeds from what we made that night, you paid for 2 guys the rent?
No, more than that. A lot more. About 8 to 10 people, we really changed their lives big time.
Right.
And, you know, close to suicidal. And people don't understand what's out there.
So what did you pay for a shrink? What did we do?
No.
I don't know what money. I did the gig with Dominic, and we did a, you know, there was I don't know how much money we raised, but there was a good amount of people there, I guess.
Yeah. Basically, you know, we get them if they need a service dog, whatever they need. You know, it's every day you don't know.
What's a service dog do?
A service dog can tell when somebody is starting to flip out because when you start shaking and before you even start sweating, the dog knows and the dog will come over and comfort you.
They help calm people down.
Yeah.
Right.
So basically.
What do they cost? Jesus Christ.
For me to buy them, I can get them for $5,000, but they
does Michael Vick sell any of those?
No.
His do the opposite.
Yeah. But the whole thing
Michael Vick can tell when another dog is sweating.
Yes. when it's around him. Yeah.
They need service dogs for Michael Vick's dogs.
Yeah. No, but like
a
these
guy,
dogs.
A
like,
guy I used to buy heroin from, his dog is the one that beat Michael Vick's dog.
Really?
Yeah.
Good.
It was at a whole ring. I gambled on one of them. I fucking lost. I go, the fucking 21st fight in a row, he would have won. And I bet on that one. Fucking,
dude.
I think a poodle killed him.
didn't Vic was try it? To buy that guy's dog? Didn't he want it?
He did. He bought it.
Oh,
you,
he
know,
did
you know the story?
Yeah, you told me off the air.
He bought it for he bought it for $50,000.
Yeah, but the vets
and then the dog lost, and Michael Vick got depressed
and killed it. Probably.
Well, and then he got a little lackadaisical, and he let his guard down, and an undercover cop got him.
Yeah,
because he was depressed. 50 G's for a dog.
Fuck
anyway,
him. But with the vets, they have
these
to wait online. Okay, they have to wait for 8 months, right? When they need them right now, and like we try to get them pushed up so they can get
how
the dogs right away.
How much money do we raise in Scranton?
Like 30, didn't we? 30 something? Thousand.
I don't know. I didn't see it. I did it for free.
Yeah, 30, yeah, so did I. 33,000, I think it was something like that.
Well,
and we got
really?
We really got to help. You know what
it's
I mean? A lot of people.
Why don't we do that and keep the money one time?
Yeah.
Well,
that's a lot of cash.
No, but this saves people's lives because, you know, they.
So does money.
What about our life?
our life, we'll always live.
And what about your life?
I'll always live. I'm a fucking vampire. But
okay.
The whole thing is with Warrior Point,
forever.
Uncle Sam's, and the Bikers for
you
Trump.
You know how much money we're going to need if we live forever?
We help people fucking live.
Well, that's good. I'm glad.
You know, we help people.
So was the
that
guy fixing airplane engines again? How did that story end?
He basically, they live in New Orleans now, and he's got a job.
Why'd he move to New Orleans?
That's where the job was.
Oh.
So we had to get him moved there. They were going to live in a tent. They go, can you get me a tent? I go, you're not going to live in a fucking tent.
The
so we paid for his apartment.
What a shit is. The guy can fix airplane engines, and he can't, he's in a tent.
That's what's going on in this country, and
so,
that's what we're trying to fucking stop.
I want to just get something straight. Where did we pay for 2 months rent? Here in New Orleans. Where do we pay for the rent?
New Orleans we pay for it.
So where was he from?
They were from Kansas, I think.
So we moved him to Kansas and paid 2 months rent?
No, we moved him to New Orleans.
Okay, and then and also paid 2 months rent?
Yeah. So basically, he can start his job
and
get his paycheck.
He got a job.
He already had the job set up. He went to training and he was ready to move, and we got him as soon as he was ready to go.
He got the job at the planes.
Fixing the engines, and it's
a hell of a skill, man.
And it makes you feel good because this, you know, this guy could go the other way and take his life like 20. to do a day, and it's fucking horrible, yeah. man. You don't, you know, people got to see what's going on there. People are crying, running around with fucking backpacks on, fucking protesting. What? You don't even know what you're fucking protesting.
What are you talking about?
These little protesters.
Oh,
out
the
there.
Backpacks. Huh?
Yeah, you know, fuck these little pricks. But, you know,
yeah,
this, is,
I agree
what,
with
this
you.
Is what matters.
Dad does that every Saturday.
Yeah, with that cub hat.
Puts a backpack on.
Yeah,
that's,
he gets $250.
That's the egregious
a day.
Part.
Backpack. Yeah, $250 he gets off Soros.
Well, all right, that's great.
Soros.
So, what is the next gig? What we're going to pay for somebody.
You want to do another gig? I would love
me,
to
no,
help.
No, not me. How am I doing it?
Well, if you want, I'll do it. I'll do it any
time. Well, what about, have you done a gig since then?
I've done a few little ones, yes. And I've donated, it's like shirt money that I've had to help people out, even for little things, just food, just whatever they needed, okay. You know? And it's something, it's a passion
How do
of
you
mine.
Buy food?
I have, we live on ice cubes, me and Dom.
I know, you can't be doing that. You have to make sure you...
I'm fine. Artie, believe me, I'm fine.
All right.
I'm happy with what I do. I'm around, you know, great people that have great ideas that...
Who
that,
are they?
That, they're basically people that were that serve that know
I hang
how,
around with me and you don't know anybody with great ideas.
Yes, we do. We,
I don't know name one of them.
Name one of them.
Dad has terrible ideas.
Well, he bought that hat. Of
that's
course,
that's what
he
I mean.
Does.
Look at his hat.
Yeah, I mean, I wouldn't fucking dress like
Anthony
that.
Anthony has good ideas. But he doesn't really hang around us.
No, but I'm saying you do good. You do something good. Something has to come back your way one day. And if it doesn't, who gives a shit? You know what I mean?
Well, you, help, I mean, you need something good to happen.
But look. As long as you have happiness in your life, you don't fucking need anything else. I don't give a fuck what anyone else says. That's why I never kissed anyone's ass. And you're the same way.
I don't have any happiness in my life, though.
Well, you don't have a...
I don't have any happiness in my life.
Yes, you do. Don't say that. You gotta, you know, you...
What happiness do you have?
What?
What happiness do you have?
I get to wake up with a smile on my face every day. No. It's called Xanax.
I know. Yeah, well, that's, I'm worried about that.
I'm fine. Dude, let me tell you something.
You claim
you're clean, you take
Xanax.
I've never been stronger in my life than I am right now.
You feel good on Xanax because you're high.
I don't take it as much. I have extra pills now because I use medicine. All right?
I don't take it as much. I have extra pills now.
At the end of the month, I have extra pills.
Bob, but you understand what I'm saying to you? This illusion of what these drug dealers we call doctors nowadays.
Exactly, but that's what I'm fighting
also. You're high on Xanax. That's why you feel good.
Exactly, but that's why I would rather have medical marijuana passed and give to some of the vets that are fucked up that need something like that.
Well, it is passed, actually.
It's not passed at all.
Well, they should go to the... We have to move them to the state where it's passed.
Well, I think that's a big thing that they need.
Anybody can get weed. I mean, come on. This will be passed. We'll get your weed.
You think it's really easy to get...
The doorman downstairs can't do the fucking crossword puzzle on the Daily News. He gets weed.
You think it's easy to get medical marijuana? You really think so?
Yeah,
it's
my
easy?
Mother could get it. She got glaucoma.
Really?
Yeah.
Got it right there.
Well, you have it there. You have it on you.
Yeah, it's like Rice Krispies.
Right.
But
so you're on weed and Xanax.
No, this is taking...
Of course you're happy.
No.
Sounds like a happiness cocktail to me.
Yeah.
Happiness, Bob, is when you're happy in life without weed and Xanax.
This, listen.
You're getting high right now.
I'm not getting high. I'm having something to eat. There's a difference there.
Dominic needs shoes.
He'll get shoes
one
day.
We have to do
a
show for that. John Entwistle had shoes.
Let me tell you something. He's better than him, and I'm going to say it again.
Okay.
I'm telling you, I'm going to send you the tapes, and you're going to see.
All right, fine. Well, I got Bob O'Reilly as a song.
You want that?
Well, that's what he wrote.
Okay. Well, oh, fuck. He played the real me. Play that for him.
Yeah, but Entwistle wrote that.
I know, but okay. Play make up your own shit and
right now.
Well, he doesn't have a bass with him.
Oh, okay. Make up your own shit. You just tell him to make up his own shit.
He can make up his own shit, and you'll be like fucking.
Well, how
holy
come
shit.
He doesn't have an album out?
He just fucking started. He's 17. You fuck.
You've been telling me this for 4 years. I'm being hard on him like you are. You put that much light, putting pressure on the kid.
Well, I do. I expect
the guys,
a lot
the
from
kid.
Him.
What I can tell you honestly is the kid is really good. You should go see him.
You see
Entwistle.
Him.
I mean, what the fuck? If people show up with a Who's Next shirt on, expect an Entwistle.
And they're going to see better.
All right. Well, you got any other gigs lined up, Dom? What about a website? What, do you have,
yeah, do you have your own band, or is Billy the Kid, is that your band?
Well, he goes from band to band now.
Oh.
Yeah, like Clapton.
Guitar player for hire.
Like Ginger Baker.
Well, they're looking for a rhythm guitar player that could sing, a keyboard player, and a solid drummer.
But so they're just five guys away from the...
Yeah.
But no, that's... Looking for a manager, record label producer.
We got all that.
You need all that stuff, or you need everybody but you.
Yeah, basically.
Yeah, yeah. Well, it's hard. It's hard to get along with a band. That's a problem.
Yeah.
Like, you know, it's especially if you're good and you write songs.
Yeah, that's what we do.
People get aggravated.
Yeah, have fun. That's what life's about. Have fun, motherfucker.
All right, calm down.
No, that's what I'm saying. If Dan wants to wear a fucking clown hat, then he can wear a fucking clown hat. He's happy. Look at him. Look how special he looks.
He is happy without weed and Xanax. That's why, you know, that's what you have to do in life.
But I... I'm happy without it.
I'm worried about you.
You're worried.
The Xanax is bad.
That scares me when Artie Lang says I'm worried about your health.
Well, I'm just saying, the Xanax is bad.
I'm cutting it down. Do you understand what I'm doing?
You've been doing that for 2 years.
Extra pills.
But I am using...
You got extra pills.
I got extra pills. They're laying around the house. The dogs eat them.
That sounds out of control.
Service dogs?
No.
First of all, the house has got to stink.
No, it doesn't.
Christine left, right?
The house does not. Oh, you're a fucking liar. That house does not smell.
No, do you
that house is fucking beautiful.
Do you live with the new broad?
Well, yeah, I live with her.
Okay, she cleaned it. Does she clean it all?
Mm-hmm.
I clean a lot.
There was a part where it was just him, and it just smelled like cigarettes and just depression.
Oh, it smells like him.
And depression.
Yeah, well, that's what the car until Scranton was so depressing.
Oh, my God.
That car was like, oh, my God, it looked like elephants ate peanuts in the front seat of the...
Yeah, but who the fuck left a fucking a big pack of fucking French fries in the back? That
I had to eat them because we didn't have any money on the way back.
I figured I'd leave Dom some food. When I go to the drive-thru and leave, he's looking over me like a cat. Like, can I get any food? I look over, he's got his snout in my bag.
His snout. Just fucking enjoying life. I get to hang out with my son after I didn't see him for many years.
That car, what took the screen, I said, this looks like a guy who's enjoying life.
Hey,
if
it's good enough for LeBron James to drive,
Kia.
A Kia.
Yeah, I think LeBron James has a Kia.
He has 10 of them.
Yeah. he gives his cleaning with him what Kias.
I know.
You have a Kia with no mats in them.
Doesn't matter. I don't need any, you know what I mean? I just drive. I don't need to fuck.
Well, what year is that Kia?
3 years old.
Yeah. Uh-huh. And what? When's the last time you cleaned the inside of it?
4 years ago.
Oh my
Before
God!
I bought it.
That ride to Scranton was so disgusting.
Oh, whoa.
That's that long. That's not a short ride either.
No, it was
a ride,
but it was worth it because you know we helped a lot of people out.
We moved a guy to New Orleans for 2 months.
And other people, we helped out a lot of people. You don't realize what good you are and how they look up to you for what you did.
Well, we'll tell them to tell me. Call me.
Well, they will. They will call you in a second.
I don't want them to call me.
I know. You'd rather get a call from fucking... who calls you at 4 in the morning? Not me.
What do you mean 4 in the morning?
4 in the morning. You get calls from people at 4 in the morning.
Yeah, you.
Not me. I'm coming down from my Xanax by then.
You and Gino Bisconti.
I don't
Gino calls me up to tell me he won't come in. I go, okay, bye.
Are you serious?
No, I'm kidding.
Oh. I was going to say you lucky fuck.
Well, this is good. So what about your plugs?
Go to RevBobLevy.com. I'll be working in Pennsylvania coming up Thanksgiving weekend. And
what do you do? You doing Wednesday before Thanksgiving?
Wednesday and Saturday at the same
place.
Those
are always good nights.
Yeah,
where are
fun.
You playing?
What's it called? The Red...
The place I play?
The Red Iron?
The Red Iron Pub up in...
But I'm playing upstairs in the... they have a catering hall, which we made into a comedy club. It's really nice.
It's in Morton, PA, I think.
It's in Springfield. Thanks for the plug, Dom. Everyone's going to be...
Yeah, I was going to say, well, you know, there's all those towns outside of Philly.
Yeah, great.
Where was the Red Roof Inn where you said you owned the comedy club? You just put a picture of you up.
Oh, no, that was in...
The
guy
didn't even know about it, the manager of the place.
No, but the
it's a huge picture leaving.
That was the biggest picture ever really I've ever seen. When I walked in, I was shocked.
Why you didn't know about it?
I didn't know about that. I knew that they were going to make the light outside that with my picture on it. Yeah. But when I seen the stage, I
was
like,
an enormous picture.
It was like, I'm not like an egomaniac at all. And it was embarrassing to me.
Right.
And probably everyone.
Well, you told me you're the best comedian ever a couple of times.
I just, no doubt about it.
There
ain't nobody faster. There ain't nobody quicker.
A portrait of humility.
Yeah. I'm not going to, I hate to pat myself on the back, but the truth is that. There ain't many better
so
that can do it.
You don't think you're an egomaniac for saying
that? No, I'm telling the truth. I'm calling myself not a liar. I'm not going to have a fucking, get on. I don't have the big push to get on TV. And there's many comedians out there. Most of the best comedians that are out there, basically nobody's ever heard of because they don't have the push. And that's
what
a fact.
Push?
Do you want me to really throw out names who suck in this fucking business?
No, I said, what push are you talking about?
People that get behind them and throw thousands and thousands, hundred thousands of dollars at them to get them on fucking stage
who
and sell
those
out.
People?
I'm talking about people that Otto Peterson.
Ellen.
Otto and George, you think, should have been a big star?
Yeah, absolutely. there's many fucking Bobby Woods, okay?
Who's Bobby Woods?
Exactly. You don't know who the fuck it is. Maybe you should look it up see where Eddie Murphy got his fucking...
Send this tape to Madonna.
and she'll probably shove it in a cunt.
Who is Bobby Woods?
Bobby Woods was used to bring
him
Eddie Murphy around with him.
Well, that's 70 years ago, Eddie Murphy.
But I'm just talking about people that...
Is that a guy who's more talented?
So
is he more talented than Eddie Murphy, Bobby Woods?
To me, yeah. To me, he was funnier
That's
on stage.
That's a big statement.
That is a big statement.
Than Eddie Murphy?
Yes.
The most talented guy I've ever
seen. Okay, he had one special. Put your second one
Bobby
on.
Bobby had four of them.
But he stopped
to make $1 trillion a movie.
So he made a fucking movie that his face got fat. Okay?
I guarantee you Bobby Woods is not funnier than
Listen,
Eddie
Murphy. There's so many comedians out there that are fucking great that don't get recognized.
Well, name them. I'll plug them right now.
I'll get a whole list because I'm working on with a show. Vic DiBattista was the guy that just made it because he got into Kevin James. Now he's selling out theaters. He couldn't sell out. There's a big difference
between...
Well,
that's not considered making it.
No, but there's a big difference between going up and kicking ass every show and not being able to fill a club because you don't have the push behind you.
What push does Vic need behind him?
He got the movie helped him. And now that they could see how funny
what
he
movie?
Is. He was in Paul Blart, Mall Cop or whatever. But now people know who the fuck he is.
Paul Blart, Mall Cop.
Whatever the fuck it's called. I seen the first one. It was me
was
and
he
him.
In the sequel?
Me and Dom were the only ones in the theater, okay?
Well, why did you, well then you said that helped him.
But it did help him because
that was the push.
It took him to where everyone going, oh my god, I seen him in that movie. I want to go see him
and
now.
And he had the viral video too.
The milk
eggs and cheese.
Yeah, milk and bread. But it helps comedians.
Milk and bread.
Yeah.
What did he say? That was his catchphrase.
No, it was basically
milk and bread.
A YouTube thing that got
milk.
Look it up, Dan. It got probably 30 million hits. He made money off
it. 30 million hits?
30 million people.
Need milk. Need bread.
Look at it. But there is tons of comedians.
I got the push.
I don't need the push. I got a
big
cock.
Big Benetto.
I got a big cock. I can sit home all day.
Well, that's what you're doing.
And I fucking love it. And I get to help people. You know, and I enjoy that. I do my podcast. I love doing it, and it's the greatest thing. You can't beat being happy in life. That's the whole fucking thing.
You have to do it without the weed and the Xanax.
I'm fine.
You have extra pill.
The end of the month.
That's my new
I'm
special.
Not on them. I have extra pills.
My new CD is coming out. Extra pills.
That would be funny.
Yeah, but I'm doing very good. I'm proud of myself because I've actually got off one set of pills and now I'm working on the next.
Well,
because it's a fucking corrupt fucking system out there.
I don't want you to watch
it's a corrupt system, what they're doing to people. They're telling them that this will calm you down and
I
you get
know.
Hooked
You're
on
right.
It.
It's terrible. It is.
It's got to be stopped.
Well, stop.
Stop.
Well, you're helping the system.
I'm not helping anymore. I'm fucking letting
How many extra pills do you have?
What do you need? I usually have about 12 to 15.
You really have edible marijuana?
Yeah.
He just ate it.
Bob, I'm worried, man.
You hungry?
The marijuana.
I'm good.
Anybody hungry? Dan.
What, are you ever happy without the pills and the marijuana?
Yeah, I'm happy all the time.
Well, when do you not take it?
When I'm sleeping. No, really.
That's when I'm the happiest.
I love sleeping, man.
When you're sleeping.
When I wake up in the morning, I feel good. I'm happy, you know.
You don't
I'm
wake
like,
up
let's
in the morning.
Go. I wake up in the early in the morning. I'm up early in the morning trying to wake this cocksucker up to write some songs and have fun.
Doesn't
and
he go to school?
Yeah, but on the weekends.
All right.
Me and him hang out on the weekends.
You live with your mother or him?
My mother.
Well, okay, yeah.
Do you like her?
Yeah.
I'm just asking you. Because you made me throw her under the bus early, you little prick.
We got to write this book. We have to writing session, right?
Yes.
Yeah.
Is that all you want to write? Is all you want to plug? The Rev Bob Levy?
Yeah, or RevBobLevy.com, too.
And what's your next gig coming up? What'd you just say? Thanksgiving. Where is that? Wednesday and Saturday? Where exactly is that again?
That's in Springfield, PA. And then I'm going to do JJ Comedy with my buddy Joe Conti, who and does my show.
And they're all at the Rev Bob Levy.
Rev Bob Levy. Okay. And then go see Dom's
band. Say the name of your thing again.
I'm playing at Southwood Bar.